Good morning. Well, it's a nice morning to be here. We're still without the white stuff, which I know some of you, maybe that depresses you, but it doesn't depress me. And so we're happy to be here and happy to be in the Lord's house today. I wanted to tell you that today is the last day for you to order poinsettias. If you want poinsettias, we'll be getting those picked up. They'll be in the sanctuary for the 18th of December. And we would need your money today for Diane to be able to get that taken care of. So that's today. And Mary has an announcement.
Good morning. I wanted to let you guys know I have placed a sign-up sheet on the piano in the back. This year again, our deacons and our congregation we're making our cookie trays for our neighborhood, servers of our neighborhood, our fire and police. And let me give you a list. We will be putting together on the 18th, 8 cookie trays to deliver the following day on the 19th to our Lawrence Park Municipal Center, Lawrence Park Police, PA State Police, Wesleyville Police, Lawrence Park Fire Department, Wesleyville Fire Department, Fairfield Fire Department, and our SafeNet. So if you wish to help us with our collection of cookies to fill the trays, you were more than generous last year and we had mounds of cookies. And these entities and the people who are working and keeping us safe throughout the day and the nights, throughout the year, were very appreciative. Several of them were very excited because they had never been included before. So if you wish to, there's a sign up in the back, and please bring your cookies or brownies or whatever. They do not have to be homemade. If you have a favorite cookie from the store, that's great. It's all edible and we all like food. So that being said, that's that one. The other one is deacons, I would like to meet with you briefly in the parlor following the church. We just want to show you where we stand for preparation for our shut-ins gifts and what Emily has brought in and has got us ready to get us started. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. I know last year, the police that sit out here in the drive, Lawrence Park police that sit out here in the driveway, every time when I go by them and stop to talk to them, they thanked us for the cookies last year that made them feel really good. And I think they had to unloosen their belts a little bit too. So sometimes it's funny what just a little thing like that can make a big difference for somebody. So if you would, please give a wave hello to our folks that are watching online. It's good for you to be with us this morning and good for us to be with you. So today is our Advent reading for the second week, and it's peace. Our Advent lighting and reading today is done by Jeff and Tina Cardo. Today we light the second candle of the Advent wreath. This is the candle of peace. With Christians around the world, we use this light to help us prepare our hearts and minds for the coming of God's Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Watch and wait for Christ's coming. Light candles of hope, peace, joy, and love, remembering the promises of God with prayer.
We light this candle in hope. And we light this candle for peace. Hear God's promise of hope from Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. A shoot shall come out from the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see or decide, by what his ears hear, but with his righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the lion, and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put its hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy, honor my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. On that day, the root of Jesse shall stand as a signal to the peoples. The nations shall inquire of him, and his dwelling shall be glorious. Let us pray. Faithful God, you are at work to restore all of creation in its intended harmony. Give us your shalom, that we may be reconciled to our enemies, and the peace that passes all understanding through Christ Jesus our Lord. God of promise, God of hope, into our darkness come. God of promise, God of hope, into our darkness come. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
If you would, please rise for our call to worship. Our call to worship this week is taken from Isaiah 9, chapter 6. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Thanks be to God. Amen. If you would please remain standing for our hymns. First hymn for today is O Come All Ye Faithful, number 249. And I want to sing everybody singing nice and loud, because we all know these songs. So And our next hymn is number 277, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Please be seated. Again, I want to welcome you here this morning. You see the readings up on the board, and you're going to see, this time of year especially, there's always a lot of readings from the book of Isaiah. And remember what I told you last week, the book of Isaiah was written 700 years before Christ was born, and it's very prophetic as to the coming of the Messiah. And so that's one of the reasons why we read it a lot. We'd read it a lot through the year, but especially at Christmas. And Neil's reading for us today, and he's got about a book and a half to read. So, but it's an important reading, and I thought about paring it down a little bit, but then I couldn't really think of anything to take out of it. So it's an important reading. Minute for mission.
Good morning. Good morning. First off, I would like to say thank you, and what an awesome job. I packed up, Priscilla. Yes, there was quite a bit of the gloves and hats and scarves and coats. If you see my car out there, I can't see out the back window. There's a lot. I plan on dropping that off this week. So awesome job. Thank you very much. That'll be much appreciated and used. So for the month of December, we will be collecting for the Christmas Joy Offering. The Christmas Joy Offering has been a tradition in the Presbyterian Church for, almost 90 to 100 years, since the 30s and 20s. This special once-a-year offering distributes money and gifts equally to the assistance program of the Board of Pensions and to Presbytery-related schools and colleges. It provides grants, financial aid to younger people going into anything Presbytery or churches, schools that cannot really afford it normally. So it's helpful. It provides also financial support to church workers and their families, current and retired and in future. Financial aid not only helps current church leaders, but also retired It's a very worthy cause, and any help or support would definitely be appreciated to make a difference. And I know in your envelope, what do they call it, containers? I'm sorry, I'm not worth it right now. In your little envelope boxes, there is a special envelope for the Christmas Joy offering. We'll be collecting for the next 3 weeks up until, I believe, Christmas. It's a real worthy cause. It's once a year. It's you know, someday it's going to help Henry. Someday it's going to help, you know, maybe our kids or somebody's kids or anything that helps this church or the Presbytery or to preach the word. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Doug. Let's bow our heads now together for our prayer of confession. Oh, Father, we are gathered before you, Maker of heaven and earth, whose chosen dwelling place is with the broken and contrite, to confess that we have sinned in thought and word and deed. We have not loved you with all our heart and soul. We have not loved you with all our mind and our strength. We have not even loved our neighbor as ourselves. Purge us from selfishness, the fear of man, and the love of praise. In your mercy, deepen our sorrow for the wrong we have done and for the good we have left undone, so that we may hate our sin with a holy hatred. But please, Father, do not leave us in sorrow. With you, O Lord, there is forgiveness. In your mercy, restore the joy of salvation so that we may love you with a holy love. Now, if you would, please take this time for silent prayer. Amen. God of peace, calm us with the peace you have given us in Jesus Christ, the one who washes us free from sin, making us as white as Christmas snow. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. And if you would say with me, our assurance of pardon. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Today, I'm going to play for you a song on this video that you've heard a million times, but I don't know if you've really understood why it was written. And this gives it a little bit of insight.
The war between the states raged mercilessly. Antietam, Vicksburg, Gettysburg, Chickamauga. Sons, fathers, and brothers from Mississippi to Maine had not come home for Christmas, and many would never return. Poet Henry Wadsworth Longfellow sat in Cambridge, Massachusetts, pondering the state of the world around him. Longfellow had been widowed for 2 years since his wife's dress tragically caught fire. And his son, Charles, was now seriously wounded, having been injured on December 1st by a Confederate bullet at the Battle of New Hope Church. As he sat nursing his son on the long road to recovery, listening to the church bells pealing forth Christmas tidings, he struggled with the message of the angels proclaiming, "Peace on earth, goodwill towards men." And he took up his pen and wrote.
Are ringing.
The church bells. Yeah, very good timing. Gives a whole meaning to a song when you realize why it was wrote. To think that Longfellow was so distraught over the war, the Civil War, and that he started this poem, but then the bells that he heard from the church bells changed his heart, and the peace of God came upon him and changed the whole way that the song or the poem ended. Let's bow our heads now for our prayer of intercession. Heavenly Father, as once again we prepare for Christmas, help us to find time in our busy lives for quiet and thought and prayer, that we may reflect upon the wonder of our love and allow the story of the Savior's birth to penetrate our hearts and minds. So may our joy be deeper, our worship more real, and our lives worthier of all that you have done for us through the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for peace. Give peace to the world. Give peace to the victims of war, the refugees, the widowed, and the orphans. Give peace to family and friends, to those who have quarreled and need to be reconciled. Give peace in our own divided hearts. We know that without justice, there can be no peace. Let peace come when all people are respected, regardless of race and religion. Let peace come when trading weapons of mass destruction is not even a thought in our heads. Let peace come when the earth's resources are used wisely for the common good. Let peace come when money is used to serve and not to enslave the world. Let peace come through the transformation of our lives, that we may do justice, show love and kindness to others, and walk humbly with our God. Mighty God, your Son came as the Prince of Peace and brought a message of peace for all people. Help us to be peacemakers in our own homes, at work, or wherever we meet people, so that the peace and goodwill of Christmas can find a place in the hearts of all people. Now, if you would, let us pray the way your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Acts 20, verse 35 tells us, In all things I have shown you that by working hard in this way, we must help the weak. And remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he himself said, It is more blessed to give than to receive. While we listen to the music of this next hymn, Let us think about how we may offer our time, our talents, or any other good gifts that the Lord has given to us to benefit and further God's will for his creation. Your tithes and offerings may be placed in the plate at the back of the sanctuary as you are leaving today. Please rise.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for these gifts that you have given to us, Lord. Please put your hands upon them and upon us to be able to magnify them to the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. And let's pray. Prepare our hearts, O Lord, to accept your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, that hearing we may also obey your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our Old Testament reading this morning comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 55, 1 through 13, which may be found on page 11, 48, 49, 50, 51, and 52 of your pew Bible. Just kidding. It is a long one. Come, all you are thirsty, come to the waters. And you who have no money, come. Buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why spend money on what it is, on what is not bread, and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen, listen to me and eat what is good, and you will delight in the richest affair. Give ear and come to me. Listen that you may live. It will make an everlasting covenant with you, my faithful love promised to David. See, I have made him a witness to the peoples, a ruler and a commander of the peoples. Surely you will summon nations you know not, and nations you do not know will come running to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel. For he has endowed you with a splendor. Seek the Lord while he may be found, call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways, the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and he will have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater. So is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but it will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills will burst into song before you, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. Instead of the thorn brush will grow the juniper, and instead of the briars, the myrtle will grow. This will be the Lord's renown for everlasting sign that will endure forever. May God bless the reading of his holy word.
This is a New Testament reading from James 3, verses 13 through 18, which may be found on page 1883 of your pew Bible. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let them show it by their good life, by deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it, or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Diane and Neil. We have to have humor while we do this. This is, God gave us humor for a reason, so. In 2003, comedian Jim Carrey starred in a movie called Bruce Almighty. In the movie, Carrey plays a Buffalo television reporter named Bruce Nolan, who wants nothing more than to be the big anchor on Channel 7 Eyewitness News. Bruce is humorous by nature, and because of this, he is usually given the lighter side of the news, feel-good stories and fluff pieces. He longs to be the big shot. And when an opportunity to have an anchor job finds it going to his rival, Bruce is distraught. Bruce is filled with envy and loves to think that he's the victim. He's so worked up after the job passes him by that he complains to God about how much his life stinks and that God doesn't really care about him or anyone else. In fact, that God is a big bully that enjoys watching people suffer and not to get what they want. During his tirade, Bruce gets a message on his pager, but he ignores it and continues to ignore it until he gets the message over and over and over. When he calls the pager number, it is about a job offering specifically for him. Intrigued, Bruce goes to the address and is introduced to someone who claims to be God, played by Morgan Freeman. And he looks like a janitor. God tells Bruce that he has heard all his complaining and decides to give him all of his powers and his job title. Of course, Bruce thinks the man is nuts, and he goes away from the meeting only to find out, though, that he does have godlike powers. At first, Bruce uses his powers to make his rival look like a fool on live television. and to create fluke disasters so that he can be the first to report on them. Soon, Bruce is the hottest reporter on the news and becomes so arrogant and not himself that his more than patient girlfriend, Grace, can no longer see him anymore. All she wanted was to be married to the man that she loved and to have a family together. But Bruce was consumed by his own self-interests, meanwhile ignoring her and what really mattered. Bruce tries to use his powers to make Grace love him again. But God had warned Bruce that even though he would be all-powerful, he could not go against someone's free will. Also, Bruce was putting off listening to prayers from other people because he was so self-absorbed, and they started to stack up. In another fit of feeling sorry for himself, Bruce decides to just say yes to all prayer requests without even knowing what they're about. While Bruce's life is unraveling, all the prayers that he answered yes to have resulted in multiple calamities. One being too many people winning the lottery. But because so many won, they won very little. And they are now rioting in the streets. And while Bruce now has the anchor job that he wanted, his first night on the air is ruined by the unexpected winning of the Stanley Cup by the Sabres, which steals his airtime. Once Bruce has witnessed the results of not doing God's job right, and that people are rioting and destroying property and likely hurting each other, he seeks out God in the original building he found him before. He finally realizes that God's job is not as easy as he thought, and that he needs God's help to make things right again. He tells God, "All I did was give people what they wanted. How could things have gone so wrong?" God then delivers what I call the best line in the movie. "Since when does anyone have a clue about what they want?" Bingo. That is the million-dollar question. This movie is a comedy, but there is a lot of truth in jest. We, like Bruce, are continually looking for our own self-interest at the expense of others, all the while blaming God for all of our woes. Didn't get that job? God's fault. Our health is screwed up? God's fault. Marriage didn't work out? God's fault. Don't make enough money? God's fault. When do we wake up and understand that we need to do what Morgan Freeman, as God, told Bruce to do? You want a miracle? Be the miracle. God has given us life. Miracle number one. Can you do it? I can't. And having babies isn't it. That's not creating life. That's just doing what the system allows you to do that God made already. God has given us talents, abilities, and intellect. Miracle number two. God has given us other people in our lives that have the talents, abilities, and intellect that we may not share to help us in our lives. Miracle number three. And God has given us his love, the greatest miracle of all. We must understand, though, that real love has no strings attached to it and does not control anyone. I always find this the hardest to teach to others. We all know that we don't want anyone controlling our lives. But whenever something bad happens, we are so quick to judge God for not stepping in and taking control. If God were really to do everything for us, to make all of our decisions and to stop all the bad from happening, what do we learn? If God really did all these things, we would rebel against him and blame him for being a controller. Either way, it seems the deck is stacked and God never wins. He has broad shoulders, though. Do any of you have children that you would do anything for? Yet everything you do is always the wrong thing or is always contradicted. Well, welcome to God's world, just multiplied by billions. So maybe some of this is sinking into you and you realize that you have some of these things happening in your own lives. Maybe you're at the stage like Bruce was where you're ready for God's help. And I'd say good, because this is the first step, recognizing that you need God. Now he can work. You have given him the go-ahead by asking for his help. He is not going against your free will in helping you, but he has already sent you the help. And we are here today to talk about this special season and to celebrate the help God sent his son, Jesus Christ. Before Jesus was arrested, he told his disciples, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid." Our English definition of peace is freedom from disturbance or freedom from a period of war. When Jesus gives you his peace, that means something much more, though. Shalom is the Hebrew word that Jesus would have used here. Shalom, I leave you. My shalom, I give you. Shalom means not just peace, but also harmony, wholeness, completeness, prosperity, and tranquility. Now let's hear John 14:27 again with this meaning behind it. Shalom, I leave with you. My shalom, my harmony, my wholeness, my completeness, my prosperity, and my tranquility, I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. Imagine that. Jesus, the Son of God, is giving and leaving with you his harmony with all creation, his wholeness, which is almost inconceivable, his completeness. Who is more complete than Jesus? His prosperity and tranquility. Wow, what more could you want? When we accept Christ's shalom, his peace, it leaves us changed. We are not self-absorbed any longer. We have others' interests ahead of our own. Bruce found that shalom too. By the end of the movie, he prays that God do to Grace what will make her happiest, even if it means not being with him, not being with Bruce. God honors Bruce's request and gives Grace what she wanted most, for Bruce to no longer be searching for greatness, but to realize that he was already created great in the first place. and to be content with his blessings that he already had, which were truly great gifts. They both got what they wanted in the end, each other together at last. We are no different. With Christ's peace that he left with us, we are happier, more content, easier to get along with, more lovable, experience less stress in our lives, and are healthier because of it. Having trouble with others in your lives, save yourselves a lot of stress by understanding that you cannot change them. You do not have that power. Nor will God use his power to help you bend free will. You can only control yourselves. Always remember what Paul wrote in his letter to the Romans, chapter 12, verse 18. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. During this Christmas season, when once can be forefront in our minds, think of Paul's teaching in Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. God's peace, his shalom, his wholeness will fill your lives with love that needs nothing else. When you feel overwhelmed with the ways of the world and how its ways can chip away at the very fiber of our beings, leaving us feeling wounded and raw, remember what Jesus said in John 16, verse 33. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world, you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. We celebrate today on this second Sunday of Advent, the shalom that only the Prince of Peace can offer. And we take hold of it with every fiber of our being. Thanks be to Almighty God. Amen. If you would please rise for hymn number 281, What Child Is This?
Mommy's love is
the deacon's prayer for the people. God, our Father, who creates all that is and all that will be, we thank you for always being with us in caring for our needs and well-being. You promise that where two or more gather in your name, you are with us and hear us. Now, Lord, hear our prayer for those close to us. We pray for Emily Tuttle as she waits for test results, the Askins family, Connie Carey, Sarah Cornelius, Phyllis Sturdivant, the Fuchs family, Lois Garfield, Florence Brower, Craig Kinney, Chris Murphy, the Drum family, Aggie Roach, Leslie Reinke, Bob Lehmer, Mary Thompson, Beverly Weber, the Wells family, John Banks, Emily Tuttle, Scott Bain, Corey and Trish Atkinson, Andrew Fisher, Joe Manuela, Fuzzy Pakella, Emily Hess, Joe Cassano, Patty Quinn, Jeff Tombaugh, Paula Tague, Betty Ann Johnson, Greg Kars, Al Alster, Sally Daglish, Sam and Roseanne Tramontana, Neil Dirchman, Ray Speakman, Karen Triana, Marla Markov, all those affected by war in the Ukraine, Adam and AJ Brine, Jake Ropaleski, Toby Charlton, and other members of our armed forces. Almighty God, may we be to others what they need, a body to work when others cannot, a heart to love those who are forgotten, a shoulder to console those whose soul is in need, a smile to brighten the most somber of your children, and a mouth to proclaim your love. Strengthen and guide our congregation to know your will and be of service to our community. Help us to be a beacon of light, gathering and leading your people to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Let there be peace on earth, and let begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be. With God as our Father, brothers all are we. Let me walk with my brother in perfect harmony. let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me.
Today I charge you to go out into the world accepting the peace, the shalom that Christ has left for us to help us in our lives and to share this great gift with every person that you meet. Let peace begin with me and watch what God can do for others. Now receive this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace today, this week, and forevermore. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.